do you have that is unique and patentable and protected and difficult to replicate? Because I've seen a lot of really good ideas for drone businesses, and the drone businesses do well. They may provide a service to a company, but then that large company goes up and spins out their own drone services division.
You're listening to the Drone Radio Show podcast, the show about drones and the people who use them for business, fun, and research. Hosted by Randy Goers.
Hello, everyone. This is Randy Goers, and welcome to the Drone Radio Show podcast, episode 202. Are you trying to find your niche in the drone industry? If the answer is yes, then you're going to like what today's guest has to say. Robert Dahlstrom is CEO and founder of Apellix, an aerial robotics company that produces tethered drones that fly in very close proximity to structures to paint, clean, and measure, among other things. The precision-controlled drones are able to autonomously complete maintenance and measurement tasks, significantly reducing costs and keeping people out of harm's way. In this edition of the Drone Radio Show, Robert talks about Apellix and its revolutionary drones, how the company found its niche in the industrial sector of the drone industry, and he shares some lessons that other entrepreneurs might want to consider as they create their own drone-based business. But before we hear from Robert, I want to thank those of you who are supporting my funding campaign. You have the option of making a one-time donation in any amount by going to droneradioshow.com/donate. Whether it's $1, $100, or much more, you can help defray the costs of production and keep the podcast going and growing. And if you'd like to make a monthly contribution, you can still go to patreon.com/droneradioshow. So let's hear how one company found its niche in the drone industry with Robert Dahlstrom of Apellix. Let's pick up the interview where I asked Robert to introduce himself.
Okay, hi, this is Robert Dahlstrom. I'm the founder and CEO of Apellix. At Apellix, we have drones that we call aerial robotic systems because they contain a robotic arm and a hand or an end effector at the end of that arm. Our current products on the market are in the area of non-destructive testing, which is where the drone flies up to a structure, computer control makes contact with the structure, hangs out, gathers some information, and then retreats and waits for the pilot to fly it to the next location and engage the software again. So we've been in business for about 4 years now. Good 2.5, almost 3 of that has been in product development.
And your drones are primarily tailored for the industrial market.
Exactly, because the value creation is so much higher. So there are a lot of drone companies out there doing a lot of things, but we've been very fortunate in the fact that we've been able to speak with people in industry for use cases that create an enormous amount of economic value for our customers. At the same time, they reduce catastrophic and other risk, and they move people from harm's way. So it's kind of a trifecta of these three convergences that really speak to businesses and bring that value creation.
Is this your first business endeavor?
So this is my second startup. So my first one was an internet security company. So I tell people, to me, drones are basically flying computers. And if you're a flying computer, drones are software. So I tell people this is my second software company.
So from your standpoint, what's it take to develop a successful business?
My typical response is, and back to my earlier statement, what is the economic value creation for your targeted customer? So in some respects, that's what problem are you solving for them, or what need do they have? What demonstrated need do they have? And what is the financial incentive behind that that would enable a business to be successful? Because you can make the best product in the world, but if it's not solving a real problem or creating value, it'd be very, very hard to be successful as a business with that product.
How do entrepreneurs today ensure that they're creating something of value? Everyone has an idea that they think will resonate with the market.
So, you know, we've seen a change in the startup ecosystem with companies and the lean startup methodology, and that's sort of almost in some respects run its course. But the fantastic thing about that framework is the focus on the customer, the focus on the minimum viable product, and the focus on interacting and fast iterations of your product to be able to serve the need of that particular customer. Back in you know, the day when I made my first business back at the turn of the century, you would build a business plan, get funding, build your product, take it to the market and immediately fail because it's not something that the market needed or the market wanted, or more likely you'd immediately pivot. Now with the lean startup methodology, before you get funding, you create your minimum viable product. You talk to your customers, get feedback for what works for them. Hopefully you get, you know, some traction with a customer, then you raise money. So it's kind of swapped the process from the way it used to be. But what's really interesting, and this comes back to what you're talking about for the value creation, is I heard the term recently, minimal viable, B-U-Y, minimal viable product instead of minimal viable product. And I think that's important because it's something that underlying the part that about buying it is the whole value creation and the economic value that it's going to create. So again, you can have a fantastic idea and a fantastic product, but if it's not creating economic value, the drivers and the incentive for the industry to adopt it is going to be much higher.
The lean methodology that you mentioned, can it be directly transferred to the drone industry? I mean, there are a lot of different aspects to the drone industry.
You hit the nail on the head with that, because in the software industry, minimum viable product, you know, with the Amazon Web Services and all the availability of the tools that exist now make that easy. Drones are different, right? Because that's a hardware environment. You've got the hardware, and then the more complicated drones or systems, you have the hardware plus you have the software. And so that is kind of a differentiating factor because it's a different type of business. And I would say it's much more complex than a traditional hardware-based business, and it's much more complex than a traditional software-based business. You have both of those elements, and they have to both work seamlessly for the product to be, you know, adoptable by the industry.
In your opinion, what goes into making a successful team in this business climate?
Any time you're starting a business, it's difficult and it's hard, and it takes a lot of persistence and dedication. You're going to be rejected a lot. You're going to be turned down a lot, but you have to have a vision and stay true to that vision. If you're fortunate enough to have a co-founder or somebody join your vision, that's fantastic. But there's always personality differences you have to be consistent and aware of, and different ways of doing things and different levels of people involvement. So some people may have a full-time job that they are reticent to give up to join the startup full-time, especially if you're not paying yourself as a founder or part of the management team. So there's a lot of trade-offs. It's very hard to start a business. And I always love to cheer for entrepreneurs because I know how tough it is.
Do you think it's easier today to start a business in the drone industry than it was a couple of years ago?
I would say it's probably harder today than it was initially. Initially, it had the hype curve, and it was, you know, drones could do anything and do everything, and everybody loved drones. But now, in the venture capital world, at least, if you use the word drone, VCs will run away because there are one or two or maybe three drone companies that have been venture funding backed that have been successful. Most all the rest of them have failed.
And why is that?
A lot of that comes back to the competitive differential. Do you have that is unique and patentable and protected and difficult to replicate? Because I've seen a lot of really good ideas for drone businesses, and the drone businesses do well. They may provide a service to a company, but then that large company goes up and spends out their own drone services division, and they no longer need to contract out to these people that provided that service or this company that provided that service in the past. So if you have something that is defensible from a intellectual property standpoint, that's so much the better.
Now, your company is 4 years old. What have you been doing to continually drive it forward? And how are you able to keep finding ways of differentiating yourself from others in the space?
Again, a lot of this is luck. Very fortunate to have a number of very talented people that are working with us to make this a reality. And a lot of it is just because what we're doing is new and fun and exciting and technologically challenging. So even though we're in what some people would refer to as a third tier city, we're in Jacksonville, Florida. We're not in Boston or Silicon Valley or New York. We still have students graduating from robotics programs in Silicon Valley and in Boston and around the world actually contacting us, wanting to come work for us. So we're able to attract really great talent coming out of the universities that have the skill set for this new cutting edge technology, because we're one of the few robotic companies out there that are on the leading edge and doing the risky, fun, innovative, exciting things. So having that fantastic pool of really talented people has just been part of what has enabled us to continue to succeed and to drive things forward. The other is the economic value. Again, as I was saying, our drones fly up to and contact a structure and measure it. There's this archaic world I didn't even know existed when I first started the company called non-destructive testing. So anything that's large and metal, like a ship or above ground storage tank or oil refineries, they all measure the thickness of the steel to determine how viable that asset is and how much life it has remaining. And they pretty much will do that on a five-year basis. So one example of value creation is a smokestack, flare stack in an oil and gas refinery. Right now, they have all these processes that feed into that stack and they burn off the gas at the top. They have to shut that down. And a person up on a crane or bring in scaffolding, take measurements with this handheld electronic device to measure the thickness of the steel. It's not unusual for that to cost $1 million or $1.5 million just for scaffolding. And the oil company can be losing $4 to $5 million in revenue during that period of time when the asset is shut down. The drones that we have that do the contact-based measurement, they don't have to shut the asset down. They don't have to scaffold it. There's a pilot on the ground flying the tethered drone that goes up there, makes contact, and takes that measurement. So the economic value is just very, very large. And because of that, we've got a lot of interest from all the large oil and gas companies in the world.
For entrepreneurs that aren't located in the typical tech centers, do you think there's more pressure on them to be more innovative and unique so that they can create their own synergy from wherever they're at?
I think it absolutely does. If you're in Silicon Valley, you're having coffee and the person next to you hear their conversation and wow, something amazing could happen. Or you could go to a meetup that exists there and only there that doesn't exist in the city that you may live in. So that is very important. But my company, Apellix, is fortunate in the fact that we're not software, we're not hardware, we're kind of this unique beast that works in this archaic area called non-destructive testing, and then pretty soon coding and painting and cleaning as well. But it's something you don't really think about or see, and it's not definitely not very sexy. It's kind of in some respects like trash removal. People don't really think about that, but there's this huge infrastructure around trash removal from your house. It's a very necessary service. Everybody has to have it, but you don't see outside the trucks that come by and pick it up. You don't see this whole infrastructure mechanism that goes along with this removal and processing of trash. The same with wastewater, all the rest of those infrastructure components. They're just amazingly large projects, millions of dollars to build a bridge, millions of dollars to maintain bridges. So it's all this unseen yet necessary infrastructure things that's not sexy, that isn't really that attractive to Silicon Valley, but it is attractive to people that are more into the industrial space. And that's actually the industrial space is where we're seeing most of the drone companies successful, because that's where there's more value creation.
In regard to your drones, are you still in the testing phase?
Oh, absolutely. So we currently have some existing contracts with some large oil and gas companies and others, and we're working as a services firm where we actually go out with our engineers and do the job. Doing that while we finalize the product to get it ready for the market. So there's a lot of benefits. One is we're out in the field actually using our robotic system to do work, and so we're learning. Two is we're interfacing and close to the customer and learning from them what are the next things that we can add to create the most value. So it's very synergistic that we're able to launch ourselves as a quasi-services company and do the work ourselves, but with the long-term goal while we're doing that is to finish our robotic system, finish up the manuals, finish up the industrial design with a nice looking shell and make the product look sexy, finish up the different things that'd be required for a product that you would then market to an end user. At the same time, in some respect, these are paid sales calls because these people we're doing the jobs for are the ones that will be the end user in the future and will be leasing these drones from us. So that's also another creation that we've taken that we haven't seen in the drone industry yet, and that's the lease concept instead of purchase. We actually lease our systems, platform as a service, similar to software as a service, and it's kind of analogous to a helicopter, right? You wouldn't buy a helicopter without also having a services plan to make sure that every time you take off that that helicopter is going to fly properly, and without having, you know, everything certified and having a pilot and the things that are necessary for operations. It's the same thing with our robotic system, because you could actually buy our system and in 6 months it would be outdated when we update our software or increase the functionality. So having a services lease, we feel is, and the feedback we've received from our customers and potential customers is a benefit. And part of it is the end user, they really don't care about the drone. They care about the data gathered from the drone. So they don't want to be drone experts. They don't want to be experts in how the system works. What they want to be are consumers of that information that the drone is gathering for them.
How are you handling all of the FAA regulations?
Well, we're atypical because our drones fly slow and fly close to structures and contact structures. They're not flying fast. They're not flying. And these are typically in remote areas. Think of oil and gas refineries or above ground storage tank farms or dams or places like that. So we're typically not flying over people. We're typically not flying very high because we're next to the structure. And we're most of the time either a tethered system or we're obviously within visual line of sight. So right now we're easily able to operate with the existing FAA regulations. And as they change and in the future, we believe that it'll just make the job even that much easier. But again, we're not utilizing the pilot so much as we are the software. So the pilot will position the drone in proximity to where they want the work to occur, and then they engage the software. The software takes over flight from there, goes in, makes contact with the structure, does the work that's necessary, backs up and hovers and waits for the pilot to then fly it to the next location to do the next test.
You know, access to capital is always a challenge. How should entrepreneurs go about seeking funding, especially in the early stages?
Well, you know, you always hear the success stories, but you rarely hear the failures. And for every success, there are quite a large number of failures. And for every person that did succeed raising funding or venture capital or whatever the funding source might have been, there were probably for that raise or that individual or that company, multiple rejections before they got to that point. So there's always going to be a lot of no's. There's always going to be a lot of kickback. So you have to make sure that you have everything extremely tight. You have the value proposition down. You have the customer list down. Possible you have some existing customers, some pre-orders for your product. It's going to be hard to get funding, no matter how good your product is or what your product market fit might be. So just be prepared for that.
Compared to a few years ago, is it more difficult today to get funding in the drone industry?
Yeah. In the drone industry, I think that's probably true. Like I said, I've heard from a number of VCs that they just don't invest in drones, period, because nobody's made money investing in drones. Most of the drone companies out there that were funded by VCs have not been successful.
So looking into a crystal ball, what do you think we'll see in the industry in the months ahead?
I think there are two things at play at a macro level. One is that it's a pendulum, right? So initially there was a lot of money being invested in drone space. Now there's very little being addressed. So it's going to swing back and forth. The other is nascent industry that's becoming established. So you're going to have roll-ups. You're going to have failures. You're going to have successes. And people are going to learn from the successful companies. And you'll see more companies that are structured in a similar fashion.
What would you say to people who want to jump into this industry, but may not know fully what they want to do or even how to go about it?
Yeah, well, I'd say two. First is on a personal level. It has to be something that you believe in, that's fun for you and exciting and that you want to do and that you're going to do regardless of what somebody says. You're just going to make it happen, come hell or high water, come funding or no funding. This is important to you. This is something you believe the world needs. Go out there, build the business and do it. So that having, you know, that excitement, that passion is very important. The other is you just have to understand that you need to find a fit for what it is that you're creating and what the value creation is going to be. What process are you modifying or changing and making better by using the drone? And then is that something that creates value? And is it something that's sustainable and replicable and, more importantly, scalable? Because you can have a great business, but it may not be able to scale. And if it doesn't scale or doesn't expand, it's going to be very difficult to get funding, and it's going to be very difficult to expand it beyond anything other than a lifestyle business.
In addition to the industrial area where your company sits, are there other sectors where you see a strong potential for drones?
I think so, yes. But some of them, you might need to be if you're a startup company, you might need to consider being a niche player in. For example, drone delivery. Everybody is excited about it. Everybody knows that it's eventually going to happen. Yes, regulations have to change potentially, but large economic value can be had. Right now, for example, I know of a drone company that is flying blood supplies from one hospital to another hospital in the U.S., but that hospital is on the other side of the river. So it's within visual line of sight, and it's not over people. So, you know, they're able to do that. But that's a very niche application. So those types of things will always be necessary, but it's going to be very difficult for you to go out there and try to create a drone delivery company to compete with any of the large companies that are also trying to get into that same space.
Is there anything that we missed that we should talk about?
Starting a company is very hard. It takes commitment. It takes focus. It takes dedication. It takes passion. And it takes desire. And it also takes the ability to take a licking and keep on ticking, you know, and keep getting punched down and keep getting back up and going at it. So you have to believe in yourself, believe in your idea, believe in what you're trying to accomplish. Hopefully have people of similar values that believe in that as well, but also people of different and complementary skills. And that's very important too. You don't want somebody that is a clone of you. You want somebody that's diametrically opposed to you, but also believes in this same idea that you do in order to be successful. At least that's, you know, my take on it.
What about the rewards of building your own business? What can you share on that?
Well, the rewards can be amazing. The rewards of a job well done and doing something fun and exciting every day is just that, a reward in and of itself. So the ability for me to get up in the morning and do something that I'm passionate about and do something that I believe is going to ultimately change the world is really energizing and exciting. So the second part is long-term for me. The payout is you get to see the birth or the creation of something. You get to see an idea being generated and turned into a better idea with other people's input, and an even better idea as more people provide their input, until you have something that the world can embrace and use, and you have actually been part of changing some process or something in the world to this new way. And, you know, drones, like we said earlier, are just at the beginning of their possibility of what they can do. So there are a lot of things in the future that these, you know, we're going to see a morph between robots and drones are going to become flying robots, in my opinion. And they're going to be able to do amazing, incredible things that we've never dreamt of or thought of, because all of us are smarter than any one of us. And so once we realize that we have these platforms, these drones that can fly around and do things, we will come up with ideas that can be added to the drones that create value, economic value, societal value, things that make the world better. I mean, in the drone industry, you hear it all the time, get rid of the dull, dangerous, and dirty work. The robot's up there to do that. Instead, use our human intelligence to do the more cognitively demanding things, the things that do make the world a better place, you know, cleaner, safer, whatever it might be.
And my final question, Robert, when you think about the two businesses that you created, is there anything about the drone industry that stands out or that you really enjoy?
Yeah, kind of. So let me just start with the origin story, might be a way. So I used to paint houses working my way through college. And I was painting my house, and I'm up on a ladder and have scaffolding. And I quickly realized I'm not in college anymore. And I thought, there's got to be a better way. So I'm thinking, well, drones. But then I'm like, well, you know, paint's heavy. Drones can only fly for 10, 20, 30 minutes. You'd have to constantly be landing, filling up with paint and with changing the batteries. So I look down, and then I'm like, umbilical cord. Keep the power on the ground, the pump on the ground, the paint on the ground, pump it up to the drone. And with software, I know I'll be able to control it and keep it the right distance from the wall to paint. So we did a sort of a pivot on that, where we actually go in now and make contact to take measurements. But the painting and cleaning drone is the next product that's coming out from our company. But the really exciting thing about that was it's innovators' epiphany, right? It's that there's got to be a better way. So having a problem that you come up with an idea for, taking that from a concept into a reality, into something that's actually then manufactured and sold or used out in the market, is just a very exciting, fun, great use of your time, in my opinion.
That's it for episode 202 of the Drone Radio Show. I hope you enjoyed hearing from Robert Dahlstrom of Apellix. I want to thank Robert for taking the time to speak with me. If you want to learn more about Apellix or want to connect with Robert, check out the webpage at apellix.com, and it's spelled APPELIX.com. If you like the Drone Radio Show, please consider supporting the podcast with a small donation. The content is always free, but for as little as $1, you can help defray the cost of production and keep the podcast going and growing. To donate, go to droneradioshow.com/donate or patreon.com/droneradioshow. Thanks for listening. Your support means a lot to me, and I hope you'll listen to more episodes of the Drone Radio Show podcast to hear how others are using drones for business, fun, and research. For the Drone Radio Show, I'm Randy Goers.
This has been the Drone Radio Show podcast. More information on today's show can be found on our website at www.droneradioshow.com. If you're using drone technology for business, fun, or research, and would like to share your experience on the show, please visit our website and fill out a guest appearance application. And don't forget to follow us on your favorite social media channels.